Gurpreet, thank you for the introduction, and also thank you for the organizers for inviting me. So in this talk, what we want to do is to discuss some links between deep learning and kernel methods and use this link to regularize better, meaning to make methods that generalize better when we don't have lots of labeled data, and also gain robustness to various perturbations. So this is a work basically that follows some theoretical work which we developed with a PhD student, so it's mostly the work of a PhD student, Alberto Bietti, who already established some links to study the invariance and stability to deformations of convolutional neural networks. And so more recently, what we did was to extend this theory to develop some practical tools. So this is something which is still not published, but it is on archive. So I will start with a brief introduction about convolutional neural networks, because when in the title I say deep neural networks, actually I'm talking only about convolutional neural networks, which is a specific type of deep networks. And so to fix the notations, what we want to do is, given labeled data, we want to learn a prediction function f, which we do by minimizing some empirical risk, as in the previous talk, and as many people do when they learn deep networks. So here the data will be the xi, the labels will be the yi. We explore a functional space that minimizes the empirical risk, and we need to regularize it in some way to help generalize better to new unseen data. So it turns out that this is not specific at all to deep neural networks. It's a general empirical risk minimization formulation. So what is specific is that our prediction functions are explicitly parameterized such that if x is an input data represented as a vector, f of x is simply a sequence of operations that are linear operations represented by these matrices w1 to wk, interleaved with simple nonlinear functions sigma. And here we have already played with deep neural networks. Probably most of you are using rectified linear units here that are simply discarding zero values in an input vector. So it's a pointwise operation. So while this represents the general structure of a neural network, in general, we often constrain these linear operations to have a smaller number of parameters than simply the parameters of a full matrix. And in particular, what we typically do with images and with sequence data is that we constrain these operations to be convolutions, meaning that you only have to learn the filters of these convolutions instead of learning full matrices. So yet, even if you do a convolutional neural network, meaning that you have convolutions, at the end, finding the optimal parameters is still a problem in huge dimension. Typically, people are learning deep networks with millions of parameters today. Even a few works are going to billions of parameters. We can see that in computer vision papers these days. And the problem is non-convex, but still basic techniques to optimize that in a huge dimension that give an approximate solution tend to work very well. So convolutional neural networks, these are relatively pretty old structures. So here is a picture from the 90s, a paper by Yann Lequin. It was a network that was designed to classify digits or handwritten characters. So it's a basic network with, let's say, few layers. And at every layer, what we see are two-dimensional maps that carry information about the input image. For example, for the first layer, here we have that this image is represented as six maps simply because it was filtered by six different filters. So we basically represent the output of the convolution on these maps. Then we can apply the nonlinearity and apply other types of transformations. For example, here, the resolution of these maps are reduced by two. There is simply a subsampling operation. And then, again, some convolutions are going on such that you obtain here a collection of six maps that have a slightly smaller resolution. And at the end, we use the vector that we obtain simply to classify. So the main features of this CNN, so why, what can explain their success, is not completely clear from a theoretical point of view, but there is still lots of intuition about it. In particular, this information about the input image that are represented on this map They tend to capture multiscale structures in images and also what we can call compositional structures in the sense that the features that are represented at layer K, they are simply functions of features from the previous layers. So this is also a model which is with a local stationarity in the sense that on this map you represent information from a local neighborhood in the input image, which we often call receptive field, and such that you have in these maps models that are for local neighborhoods in the image at different scales. And what more importantly, when you have lots of labeled data, we know that this is, and you have structured data such as images, this gives a state-of-the-art result for many, many applications. So when it goes through interpretation, things are a bit more complicated because we can visualize filters if we filter an image. But we cannot directly visualize filters that are in the middle of the network because they are the result of a highly nonlinear process. So what people have done in the few last years was simply to try to generate images that would, in some sense, yield large values on these feature maps, such that we can then try to say, well, this is an image that will maximally excite what we call to be a neuron. So when we do that, for the first layer, it's easy because we can visualize the filters directly. And what we observe is that these first layers, they often represent very low-level structures such as oriented edges or transitions between opposed colors like this. And when we go up in the hierarchy, we obtain images that are a bit more complex with a bit more textures or even maybe some semantic meaning. So these are some images that were obtained in 2013, but it turns out that more recently people managed to produce better looking images. That's basically the only thing we can say about these images, that they are good looking. There is not much scientific quantities that we can use to really say this is that these images are representing the activity of a specific neuron, but still there is maybe some intuition we can get from them. So if we look at here the images that are generated to maximally excite some neurons for the first layer, we see some sort of oriented images with lots of oriented edges. And then interestingly, when we go up in the hierarchy, we obtain more and more complicated patterns. So which tends to give the intuition that these convolutional neural networks, when we go up in the hierarchy, they do not represent only edges, but more and more textures. And when we go up, we can even see some strange images like, you know, this one that show that maybe there is also some semantic meaning when we go to the last layers. For example, here, so I don't exactly know what this is, but there are some eyes that seems to be here, meaning that maybe this in part of the network is detecting eyes in images. And maybe legs here or other types of structures. Okay. So now, these convolutional neural networks are really state-of-the-art when you have lots of labeled data, but there are still many problems with them. So what are the current challenges to solve? I mean, there are more challenges than that, but the challenges that are interesting to me these days are the following ones. There is a lack of stability that I will mention next. But what is also important is that this success is based on a huge annotation effort, meaning if you take the ImageNet database, for example, it has, I don't know, today it has maybe 10,000 classes, more than 10 million of hand-labeled images, and for many applications, it's not something that you can afford to do. If you take autonomous driving cars, for example, all of the labs that are working on that are doing data acquisition at a massive scale, and they are also hiring armies of annotators to annotate images. So learning with few labeled data, it means when I say it's a problem, it doesn't mean that if you take a convolutional neural network, you will not find an architecture that does not produce decent results, but it means that there is a huge, before, when you have lots of data, there is a huge gap between the traditional computer vision techniques, that were based, for example, on handcrafted features like SIFT and disconvnets. But when you don't have lots of labeled data, the gap is very small, or maybe there is no gap. So that's a bit, that means that there is a strong limitation here that we have to fight. Now, when we look in the extreme case, when we want to learn features without labels, so it's simply doing unsupervised learning with this convolutional neural networks, there are also many ways to do that. There are many types of autoencoders that can simply try to reconstruct signals and learn features. Now, if you take these networks and you train them without supervision, and let's say you simply take the output vector as the representation of an image, you could evaluate the quality of these features on a supervised task by simply plugging these vectors into a linear classifier like a support vector machine or logistic regression. And if you do that, you see that the performance with respect to supervised methods is actually very far. So here, this is some accuracy measure on the ImageNet database. And basically, all of these are state-of-the-art methods to learn convolutional neural networks without supervision. And the accuracies we get are about, let's say, between 30 and 40%. So I know that this table is like 2 years old, but still the numbers that we have today is not much larger. Now, what is disappointing here is mainly that if you take previous generation of computer vision techniques that were based on SIFT representations plus Fisher vectors, they were also representations that were fully unsupervised. And the performance that we had before was simply much larger than this. So it means that here we have a gap between, for unsupervised learning, between the quality of features we obtain using convolutional neural networks and what we used to do before without deep learning. So I'm not going to talk much about unsupervised learning today. What I want to talk is about learning without lots of labeled data and talk also about stability. So what is the stability issue? The stability issue is that you may know, you may have seen that, because these are things that are pretty popular, that even sometimes we see in the press, that these deep learning networks are subject to what are called adversarial attacks. It means that given a network that has been trained, let's say on ImageNet, if you give it a new image, it will probably classify it correctly, but if you give it a new image that you have slightly corrupted yourself in an adversarial way, then it can completely break the prediction performance. And what we know today is that these adversarial perturbations that we can generate for each image, they are just not numerical artifacts, they are perturbations that can live in the real world. For example, here is an image which is not that exciting. These are two washers that are probably from some image database. And it turns out that we can train a deep net, and then at test time, it's relatively efficient, so you can implement it on a cell phone, on your smartphone. And if you print this image on a sheet of paper, you take your smartphone and it will classify it correctly. It will say, well, it's a washer with 53% confidence, whatever it means. Now, it turns out that this image here, it will say, well, I believe it's a safe with 34% confidence and maybe still a washer with 22%. And now you give this image, it will say, well, it's a safe, I'm pretty sure it's with 37% confidence and maybe a loudspeaker with 24% confidence. So here you cannot see what is the difference between these images. What happened, in fact, is that these images were engineered by people have simply developed an optimization technique to find some very tiny perturbations that you can hardly see, but that will simply change the prediction. So this is a problem because these are things that were actually engineered numerically at some point, but then they were printed on a sheet of paper and still your best deep network is unable to classify it correctly. So if you think about systems that are going to take automatic decisions, you don't want them to be, you want them to be robust to these sorts of attacks. For example, recently I saw, I mean, it was actually this morning in the train, so I had to take the train at 6 a.m. to come here. So I wasted a bit of time on the internet, and I found that recently people have have tried to attack the autopilot from Tesla. And actually, they have shown that you can engineer perturbations that can live in the world, that you can put stickers on the road that will break some predictions made by Tesla. So there were two sort of things they could show that they could break the detection of lines on the road, and also change the they attacked also for some reason basically these attacks can exist in the real world, and for the first time we have seen that a commercial system could be subject to things that could lead to something pretty dangerous, and it's probably only the beginning of it. So all of this problem of generalization with few labeled samples and also the robustness to adversarial perturbation is in some way related to the issue of regularization. So basically today when you train a deep network, we use lots of heuristics to make them to regularize. So for example, you may have heard about dropout. So it's a way to introduce stochastic perturbations during learning, but it's not something that is used that much today. Weight decay, something simply saying, well, I'm going to penalize the weights of my parameters. It looks something pretty natural to do if you train any machine learning model. And the most important heuristic may be early stopping, meaning you don't optimize as much as you can, you stop at some point. Simply by looking at the error on the validation set, and when this error is still reaching some point, and you may stop optimizing. So all of this, we know it's not sufficient because for the problems we mentioned before. So at the end, one of the big questions we may want to ask is, well, is there really a way to control the variations of a prediction functions? Because when we talk about regularization, most of the time what we try to do is to induce smoothness in your prediction function. And a way to control smoothness is to control how far will be a prediction f of x compared to f of x prime when x and x prime are close to each other. So of course, the problem here is that it raises important questions. So the first one is, what does it mean for x and x prime to be similar? So we can talk maybe about visual perception, probably not about L2 distance here for images. And even if you have a good definition of similarity between x and x prime, how do you use it to regularize? What would be a good regularization function omega here? So here now I will take a new hat. I will try to use tools from machine learning that were very popular in, let's say, the 90s up to 2005. And that were also mentioned in the previous talk, so it's not that old-fashioned. And so basically the kernel perspective, what it means, it's simply, if I have to give a three-line recipe, it simply means you take a data point and you send it to map it to a Hilbert space, which we called reproducing kernel Hilbert space, or RKHS. And the first effect of doing that is that even if your data is any type of structured object, it can even be a tree or a graph, when you map it to this space, then you have some geometry. It means that you are in a space where you can compute angles, you can do projections of points on linear subspaces, you can reduce the dimensions by doing that. You can compute barycenters, you can do lots of operations. And simply mapping data to a Hilbert space is not something which is very nice from a computational point of view. So in fact, what we do is that we do all of these things implicitly using what is called a positive definite kernel, but it doesn't matter that much for this talk. For this talk, we simply mean we map the data to a Hilbert space. And this particular Hilbert space is specific in the sense that the predictive models that we are going to consider, they will be points themselves in the Hilbert space, and they will be simply parametrized as linear functions. So f of x here is now simply a linear product between a point f that lives in H and this phi of x, which is the mapping of your data to the Hilbert space. So basically, you send your data to a space of very large or possibly infinite dimensions, and there what you do is something very simple. You work with a linear model. So all of this, so now what is the relation with deep networks? So all of this does not look like very close to what we do in deep networks, but in fact, it's still possible to design a relatively complicated space, which will be multi-layered in some way that I'm going to define, where you have a large class of deep neural networks that live, such that if your deep networks f of x, which is represented here by these parameters, live in the RKHS, it means that it can also be written as simply an inner product in a specific space after sending your data in this space. So this construction, I call that convolutional kernel networks. It's a way, in some sense, to linearize a deep network. Because here, this is simply a linear function. So there is one important effect of this linearization is that here we will, in fact, completely decouple two things. So here on the right side of the inner product, we have this phi of x, which is the way you implicitly represent your data in this Hilbert space. It's typically something that depends on the network architecture that you choose. It's independent of the training data. And then you have f, which is the model. It's the model that makes the prediction. So this is the one that you're going to learn on the training data. So in some way, if you use this principle, what you do is that you completely decouple data representation, which is here, and learning, which is represented by this quantity. So now you can ask yourself many questions. So that was, in fact, the topic of the object of study of my PhD student, Alberto Bietti. So first question, this phi of x, well, which is related to the network architecture, and which is independent of training data, you can ask yourself, is it something which is stable in some sense? Does it lose signal information or not? That's a natural question to ask, since we are talking about data representation. And when we consider the predictive model F, a natural question is, well, can we control its stability? Can we upper bound or control this quantity, which is the deviation F of X minus F of X prime? Now, in fact, you can. There is a basic inequality that tells us that this quantity can be controlled by the product of two terms. One of them is simply some distance in this RKHS between phi of x and phi of x prime. So this is the distance between your data points. And then you have this quantity that does not depend on x, that only depends on the model, which is the norm of f in the RKHS. So here what this means is that if you had some sort of stability here for this mapping phi, if you want to have some sort of stability for f, what you need is to have to control this quantity. And this quantity is what we typically control in kernel methods to regularize. Here it will control both the stability and the generalization. So I will summarize the results of this paper by Alberto Bietti, so I don't want to go into the technical details of this paper. What I want to do today is more go to the follow-up. So the summary of this result is that, well, it constructs an RKHS for deep networks that contains classical convolutional neural networks up to one small difference, is that instead of the classified rectified linear units, what we call these activation functions, we will require this activation function to be smooth based on the smooth function and homogeneous. I will give you an example of that on the next slide. And so then, what we study in this paper is also conditions to have signal preservation. So meaning this mapping, which will have some stability property, we want still it to be in some way invertible. And we will show as well that we can show some non-expansiveness and stability to deformations for this kernel mapping. So for those of you who are familiar with the work of Stefan Mahler on the scattering transform, maybe many of you for this imaging community, what we essentially did was to take Stefan Mahler's work and extend part of his results to more general convolutional neural networks using this kernel point of view. So that was our main contribution. And then there are also extensions to achieve invariance to other types of transformations. So that's on the signal representation part. Now on the learning part, what I told you in the previous slide is that this kernel mapping, if it has some stability, if you want your prediction function to be stable as well, you need to translate the stability of phi to the stability of f. And you see here that what we need is to control this quantity. So what we also do is to compute some upper bounds, some bounds on this quantity, such that we can then control this norm. Because what is a bit unfortunate here is that this quantity here, the norm of a deep network, is typically a quantity which is intractable in our framework. So we need to do approximations if you want simply to get an idea about the magnitude of this quantity. So I promised you I will give you one clarification about smooth homogeneous activation functions. So here is on the left is a comparison with the rectified linear units in blue, and something which is a smooth approximation of rectified linear units. Turns out that this smooth approximation is kernel compatible in some way, whereas the rectified linear units is not. Why is that? Simply because in kernel methods, there are lots of functional spaces that we like to define that contain smooth functions only. And rectified linear units are non-differentiable here. On the other hand, we can also consider a smooth approximation, and when you use that in your deep network, it doesn't change much at the end. So I told you something which was maybe a bit confusing, which was, well, smooth plus homogeneous. So homogeneous, it's like rectified linear units. You take a ReLU of gamma x, it's gamma times ReLU of x. It doesn't sound very compatible with the smoothness assumption, especially at zero. So in fact, when I say smooth plus homogeneous, it means that. It means here that instead of rectified linear units of some w times z, what I'm considering here is a sigma, so the smooth ReLU of w times z normalized by the norm of z. And to make things homogeneous, then I add back the norm outside of this quantity. So this is the only part which is not completely standard with respect to traditional convolutional neural networks, because a traditional convnet will in fact use either ReLU or maybe the smooth ReLU. But if you think about it, ReLU is homogeneous, so you can also simply think about this as a better approximation of rectified linear units. It is based on the smooth function sigma, and it is homogeneous like a ReLU. So now we come to the main topic of this talk, which is about regularization. So assume that we have some RKHS for your deep networks. Then you know that this quantity, the norm, encourages the smoothness with respect to the geometry induced by the kernel, which depends on the architecture that you have chosen. So at the end, what you would do if you were a machine learning person and familiar with kernel methods is to say, well, I will try to replace my empirical risk minimization, where I'm optimizing over deep networks, over simply a more abstract optimization problem, where I will simply explore this reproducing kernel Hilbert space, and I will regularize by this norm. Now, what is unfortunate is that what I told you before is that these kernels that we developed, they are computationally intractable, which means that we need to do something. So one thing I did, in fact, that was a few years ago, was simply to use traditional kernel approximation techniques. And Alessandro is, in fact, his work is very well known about kernel approximation, so we have a very nice expert in the room. And when you do that at every layer, then it leads to an object which is called convolutional kernel networks. But this is not the subject of this talk. What I want to talk about today is the regularization of traditional convolutional neural networks, not these new objects. So in fact, what I do is that I consider a classical convnet represented by this function f theta with parameters theta that represent, let's say, the filters of your convolutional neural networks. And then I want to regularize still with the norm, which is here the norm of f theta. So this is different than in the previous slides, because here we are not trying to explore the full RKHS. What we simply want to do is to adjust the weights of a deep network, which is a very classical problem. Now, there is still an issue. Before, we had a norm which was intractable. Here, the norm is still intractable for this f theta. So one solution we propose is to simply use approximations. And here, that will be based on either upper bounds of this quantity, tractable upper bounds, or tractable lower bounds of this quantity, or a combination of both. And at the end of the day, what worked best was always a combination of upper bounds and lower bounds for these norms. And this is the subject of this talk, just to clarify. So I will give you examples of these norms, and, but since I have time, I will also quickly give you an idea about the construction of this RKHS for deep networks. So here I will give you only two slides about it. And what I will give you more precisely is the construction of the RKHS for continuous signals, because it makes things simpler, but we can do the same for discrete signals. So what is a continuous signal? It's an integrable signal that takes value on some continuous domain omega, which is RD, takes D equal 2 for images, and that takes values in some Hilbert space H0, which is, let's say, R3 for RGB images. So now question, how do you build a map XK from a map XK minus 1? So what we are going to do here is to build a sequence of representation of your image that will be starting from X0, we'll go to XK minus 1 and to XK, that are two-dimensional maps for images that carry information from local neighborhoods in the image, like traditional convolutional neural networks. And what we want to do is that when we go up in the hierarchy, on these maps, we have information from larger neighborhoods with more invariance. So that's what will happen with this construction. And so the building blocks of this construction is to take this map XK minus 1, XK minus 1, which lives in L2 of omega to HK minus 1, and then we will build a map that lives here, that takes value in the same domain, but the points live in another Hilbert space. Typically, I told you they will correspond to larger receptive fields if you want to use the terminology of deep neural networks. So what we do is that we apply a sequence of three operators, PK, MK, AK, and what PK is doing is simply it's extracting neighborhoods from the previous map, such that if you consider the value at PK XK minus 1, what this is, it's simply a patch centered at U in the previous map. So we call that a patch extraction operator. Then the operation MK, it's pointwise, meaning that for every patch, it will map it to a point in a new Hilbert space. So what the traditional ConvNet is doing is to take a patch and map it to a vector of some dimension. Here we do things that are a bit more abstract. We take a patch from your continuous signal and we map it to a point in a Hilbert space. And then after this, we do a pooling operator that is simply a smoothing operator that we apply on these maps. So here, if we visualize this, it means we have our map XK minus 1. We consider a patch, and this patch is mapped to another Hilbert space, represented as a point here. And here we have a smoothing operator with a Gaussian filter that gives us a map XK. So here, it's not obvious at all why this construction should correspond exactly to traditional convolutional neural networks, but in fact, it's something we can show that I won't do here. Okay, what is the multilayer representation? First, the multilayer representation is simply obtained by taking X0 and applying a sequence of layers such that Xn at the end is the way you represent an image using n layers of this construction. At the end, once you have phi n, the prediction is done simply by using a linear model. Okay. So this is a way to represent images, to map images to a very high dimensional space, which is in fact infinite dimensional. It's a Hilbert space. And what we can show is that this relatively abstract space contains traditional convolutional neural networks when they have smooth homogeneous activation functions. There are many details that I didn't present here, but it's something we can show. So now I want to insist about the practical aspect. So now what can we do if we have our empirical risk and we want to regularize with the norm? So you want to find the parameters theta of your deep net, and you want to be able to control this quantity. So there is a first natural upper bound that comes from this construction, which is simply a function which is strictly increasing with respect to the spectral norms of the filters. So it simply suggests that controlling the spectral norms of the filters is good for stability. And it's something that can be derived from many other point of views. In particular, there is practical work by Miyato here that uses that, the normalization of the filters using the spectral norms to stabilize the training of what are called generative adversarial networks, which are relatively difficult to train. There are also theoretical work by Bartlett that where similar quantities appear as a way to generalize, to control the generalization capabilities of deep networks. And also there are works that also use the, in some way the spectral norms of the filters. Now, these are only upper bounds, and we have absolutely no guarantee about the tightness of this, the bounds that we have here. So we decided also to look at lower bounds as a proxy for the norm. And for lower bounds, there are many interesting things that come from this. So how do we obtain a lower bound for this norm? The first thing we do is that we simply rewrite the norm using a variational form that is valid for any Hilbert space, where the norm is equal to the sup when you optimize over u being in the unit norm, unit ball of h. And so this is not that helpful here because I told you this is intractable. It means that this is also intractable. Now the idea is to replace this constraint by a subset of this constraint by simply optimizing over a subset u such that u is in this unit ball. So what we do is that we design sets that lead to a tractable approximation that leads to techniques where you can actually optimize. And the only thing is that it requires some knowledge about the properties of H and about the mapping phi. Typically what we want is that you have some guarantees that we have this, and ideally we want this to be as large as possible inside this ball. So first thing we know about phi is that if you construct your RKHS in a particular way, you will obtain a mapping phi which is non-expansive, such that if you take a set U, which is simply phi of x plus delta, where so x is your image, delta is let's say an additive perturbation of your image, minus phi of x, where delta is bounded in L2 norm, it turns out that using this set U leads to this quantity here, which is that, well, lambda times, so this is, we should call that a definition, by the way, but the lower bound from the previous slide, if you multiply it by lambda, it will lead to this quantity. So by defining this set, because of non-expansiveness, we know that u is inside the ball, the unit ball here. This quantity here becomes this one. So what we have here is that we have the sup over x and the perturbation delta, bounded perturbation of f of x plus delta minus f of x. So it leads to some strategy to regularize, where you have the empirical risk, and you have also this quantity where, that you need to take into account. So what we see is that now instead of a minimization problem, we have a min and a sup or min max. It means it's a bit more complicated to optimize. Maybe we need to use some heuristics. We have also here a global optimization problem over the domain, which is maybe difficult to handle. But if you do some approximations of that, you can also use that to regularize. It will simply encourage stability of your function by making it as much Lipschitz as you want, if you prefer. So this is related to what people call adversarial regularization, which was often used, I mean, mainly used to gain robustness to adversarial perturbations, where you also have a min-max, but here you maximize over the perturbation in the loss term, and here what we do is that we simply operate only on f. So it's very related to this robust optimization formulation, except that we operate without using labels. So here this is simply a quantity that depends on f theta, it does not depend on the loss, it does not depend on the labels. Yes. So that was simply to make a link with principles, regularization principles that exist. You may have seen in the recent literature as well that people start to penalize the gradients of the loss functions when they learn deep nets, in particular to train again these generative adversarial networks that are very unstable. So if you take now this, I forgot in fact, did a copy paste in the train this morning, so there is a normalization missing here. So this set is wrong, but I will update the slides after the presentation. If you use the same set as before, but you divide, in fact, by it should be probably the norm of delta, then you will obtain at the end a lower bound, which is simply the sup of the, it should be here depending on if on the gradient of f of x when x is optimized over the domain. So there are related penalties that have been used to stabilize the training of these GANs, generative adversarial networks, and also to improve the robustness to adversarial perturbations. What people have done as well is to consider the gradient of the loss or the expectation instead of max. So it's also related to many things that have been done in the literature. Now, what is a bit more interesting is that so far, the only knowledge about phi and h that we have used was the non-expansiveness. But in fact, we have also shown that there is some sort of stability to deformations, which is something very specific to this constructions of convolutional neural networks. So we can also use that. If you define a set which is simply phi of, so L tau x is simply a small deformations of x using a diffeomorphism minus phi of x, then it leads to a lower bound, which is simply the sup over x over small deformation of f of L tau x minus f of x. It's related in some way to what people call data augmentation, where instead of maximizing, they will simply sample lots of deformations and add them to the training data. And it's also related to an old strategy from neural nets called tangent propagation. So it's related. It's not equivalent, it's simply related because they also consider deformations of images to regularize. So, now question, how does it work in practice? So we have many tables. So what we did was to take standard architectures, such as what are called ResNet or VGG, if you know these architectures. So our goal was not to design architectures that will generalize better with few samples. Our goal was to take a generic architecture that is normally not necessarily designed to handle few samples, but to show that if you regularize them correctly, you will improve significantly the quality of the results. So we show numbers with data augmentations or with data augmentation, and we also use early stopping, okay, which is also very important when you don't have lots of labeled data. So that's our baseline. Our baseline is that a deep network, let's say with 1,000 of samples on this data set, would produce 50% accuracy using data augmentation and using early stopping. Now what we see is that there are plenty of baselines, so these are the lower bounds that I presented. This means a combination of upper bound, so spectra, this means a spectral norm and lower bound. And basically from all of these numbers, all we can basically say is that regularization helps relatively significantly. Now here we didn't use deformation, so using deformation is in fact more interesting, I think, because it's already using more knowledge about the norm that we have defined. And so here we look at the dataset MNIST, a very old digit classification dataset. We look at what this standard architecture VGG is obtaining when you have only 300 labeled samples, meaning 30 samples per class. What we see is that if you do nothing, or you still do early stopping, what you obtain is about 10% error here. And by doing a combination of things, you can obtain less than 5%. So you can divide basically the error rate by two by regularizing in an appropriate manner. So that's what we say here. And the interesting thing is that we compare this upper bound with lower bounds, and always something which is relatively consistent is in all of our experiments is that by combining the upper bound and the lower bound was always useful compared to only using lower bound or upper bound. We do also an experiment on biological data. It turns out that convolutional networks are useful to handle DNA sequences. And here, this is a classical data set with genomic data where we turns out some of the, it's a typical setting which is complicated for ConvNets because in genomics, in computer vision, you have often a single task, we have lots of data. So you can tweak a long time your parameter, maybe on a validation set. Often it's done by hand. here with genomic data, you may have 1,000 of data sets with not that many samples per data set. Sometimes you have lots of them, you may have 10,000 of samples, sometimes you have only a few hundred of samples. So what it means that you need to do things in a relatively automatic manner, you cannot tweak things by hand, and this is also a case where regularization seems to be very helpful. So here, this is a standard measure for this sort of benchmark, and we took only here the I did not even put the name of the database, but we took specific subset of the database where there is not much training data to illustrate the effect of regularization. And what we obtain is that if you don't do nothing here, you have this 44 IUROC 50, and you can go up to 60 by doing again a combination of lower bounds and upper bounds. So that was for me the most interesting part is simply that we can derive many regularization principles from this point of view, and we see that if you combine both upper bounds and lower bounds, it's something that is useful. And I just, for the statisticians in the room, I have put many, many numbers on these slides, but we have done statistical tests at some point just to validate at least these numbers in bold. And now the last slide I want to present is about adversarial robustness. So adversarial robustness, typically what we do is that you take a data set like CIFAR-10 and you define an adversary that will try to optimize your loss function in the opposite direction given any new test data. And what we see is that if you don't do anything on this data set CIFAR-10, if you take this network to VGG, it achieves about, here the standard accuracy means about 10% error. And here on this axis we have the adversarial accuracy, means the accuracy after the adversarial attack. Here it means that you go from, it means that you go from 90 to 5%. So you can completely destroy your network simply by playing with these adversarial perturbations. So now what is the effect of regularization? So this is what we see on these curves. So we have one curve for each method. And basically, for example, here, this is what happens when you increase the regularization. On this yellow curve, for example, we go from, let's say, something like 87. You make the bottle smoother, you increase the regularization, meaning that you are going to lose in standard accuracy here, up to something like 77. But the good thing is that you are also gaining, you are losing a bit in standard accuracy, but you are gaining a lot in adversarial accuracy. For example, here you go from 5% to 50. So here it's maybe we can see, this is also achieved with fairly large perturbations. Here this is the large perturbation regime, this is the small perturbation regime. So it still means that there is no magic. I mean, the models are still losing quite a lot when we were in a fully adversarial setting with large perturbations, meaning that instead of 90% accuracy, in the best case, here we have 50%. But still, at least, we don't get 5% accuracy. So we get models are becoming much more robust if you do things properly. So I don't know if there are other conclusions to draw from that. Probably there are too many curves for you to already see that, but at the end the conclusion was that I think again the combination of upper bound and lower bound was useful in some regime. Here there is no clear winner for all of these techniques. There is no technique that is uniformly above the rest. For example, the red one here is better in this regime, the yellow one is better in this one. But simply it shows that regularizing is important for this question. So to conclude, what we do is to give some sort of unified perspective on many regularization principles. So there are existing ones. You have also new penalties that are related to these principles. We show that regularization is useful both for generalization and robustness. And part of it was also related to robust optimization. So what we try to do in future work is we are trying to develop other regularization strategies that are based on kernel approximations. You have seen that these penalties, they do not depend on labels, so it's pretty natural to say maybe it can be useful for semi-supervised learning. And maybe simply from a theoretical perspective, we also would like to understand a bit better the effect of optimization. So when you use stochastic gradient descent for these problems, it has an effect on the generalization capabilities of the networks, and maybe there is also a link with the networks with the kernels that we develop here. I will stop here. Thanks.
Okay, so some questions for Julien. Start on the left.
Yes, on the regularization term that you added, there was a lambda parameter, regularization parameter, but slowly it disappeared and replaced by theta, yeah, f theta.
So the lambda is the regularization parameter, whereas theta are the weights of the network. Did I forget lambda at some point? Did it disappear? Maybe you're right. Yes, it was a bit hidden here, indeed, yes. Okay. So here it's because this, if you use this lower bound, will correspond to that. Mm-hmm. So in fact, what lambda will always be here, yes.
Okay, so
yes.
The upper and lower bounds depends on...
Yes, all of them will have a regularization parameter. I mean, there is no parameter-free approach here.
Some other questions? Okay.
Yeah,
please.
So I found very interesting in the curve that you showed at the end for the adversarial robustness that it seems that the curves are first stable and then they bend, as if there's sort of a breakdown point and then there's something that collapses. Is that related to the value of lambda? Can you comment on that?
So to obtain the different points on these curves, you change the value of lambda. Typically, if you increase the regularization, you go to the left. Now, these things are also curves that sometimes are a bit unstable. If you talk about the green one, I don't know what happens here. Because to obtain each point, even to evaluate, we have also to solve a non-convex optimization problem. So it's not always clear, but where you are right is that indeed there is often a point where it breaks, like here. But we don't know if it's due to the mathematical property of the problem or if it's due to the fact that there is a regime where we don't know how to optimize correctly. So that's something I would have liked to... We don't have a clear intuition about that. Because there are two issues here. If you don't do bad, either you don't optimize well or your model is wrong. And here I don't know exactly what is... it's not something that we have studied and I'm not aware of any results that will clearly explain why we have suddenly this effect. Maybe there is some phase transition going on, but that will be already hand wavy if I say that. Yes.
Okay, so, question. It's to be recorded because the talk is recorded. It will be recorded.
Thank you. My question concerns the metric on the kernel space itself, because you motivated your work by saying that you want somehow the output of the network not to change too much when the inputs are closed, and the similarity in the input space, you said that it should be perceptually meaningful. So, and also you demonstrated that it's independent. You have the phi term that is independent on the training, on the learning. So the question is, do you have any idea of what architectures are good in terms of the internal metric of the kernel space?
Yeah, so what we show, not in this talk, it was in the journal paper I mentioned at the beginning, is that we don't work about visual, we don't have lots of experience about visual perceptions, but what we can show is that there are specific architectures that lead to this stability to deformations. And what you need basically for that, in a classical, it's something very consistent with these VGG architectures. You need small patches. Large patches lead to instabilities. That's something we can show. So small patches, plus when you subsample, so when you reduce when you do pooling in your architectures, you should not subsample more than the size of the patches. Otherwise, you will lose too much information. So basically, it means small patches, 3x3. When you do pooling, don't do pooling by more than a factor 2. That's exactly consistent with the VGG architecture. So that's to obtain the stability to deformation. This is what we need.
Okay. If there's no question, we can thank Julien for his talk.